This video is on the origins of life and is the first video of the evolution of organisms topic. So in this video, we're going to look at some of those really early starting off events that led to life on Earth. So our key concepts from the subject outline are that there's evidence that Earth had life around 3.5 billion years ago, that existing cells are the products of evolution, that this may have started off with spontaneous formation of membranes and the action of RNA, and that prokaryotic cells probably existed before eukaryotic cells. So let's just have a look back at the cell theory then. So the cell theory has three main points, and you should know all three of these. First one is that all organisms are composed of cells, one or more cells, single-celled organisms or multicellular organisms. The cell is the basic unit of structure and function and organization in organisms, and that all cells arise from pre-existing cells. Now, the third one can be a little bit problematic. If we're talking about the origins of life and it says that all cells came from pre-existing cells, then that can't quite be true because they weren't always cells. So at some point, there must have been something that was before the first cell in order to get this going. So how is it possible that a cell arose, the original cell or cells? How do they arise? So when we think about that, we've got to think about, well, what is a cell at its most basic? What could the simplest possible cell be? So a cell would need to have some form of self-replication, be able to have a molecule or genetic material in some way that can copy itself and form a new copy. And that is the basis of reproduction, which is an important part of cells. The other part of cells that we know about is that they have a membrane around them. Otherwise, it's just a molecule out there in the sea or out there in a swamp or something like that. In order for it to be a cell, it really needs to have some sort of membrane around it. So how can these things happen? So we need to have some sort of molecule that is the genetic information and hopefully does some stuff as well, and some sort of membrane around that. So the simplest thing that we can start to consider is a molecule like RNA, and I'll talk on the next slide about why RNA might be the simplest molecule for self-replication here, and then some sort of membrane around that. Luckily, there is some evidence that this might be the case. Now, there's no fossil evidence of the first cell, obviously, because it's too small and too long ago, and there's no genetic evidence either, so we can't really go back using our normal techniques to look at this. What we can do is do modeling experiments and find that when we have lipids and fatty acids, they can spontaneously form into bubbles, like vesicles, that are the starting point of a cell, make a membrane in some way. We can also look at existing evidence of RNA and the way it operates within cells, and perhaps provide that as a conjecture to how RNA might have been that early molecule inside the cell getting things happening. So, here's a page looking at ribozymes. Now that combines the idea of a ribonucleic acid, RNA, with an enzyme. So RNA can actually bind to itself through base pairing to make complex 3D shapes. So here's some base pairing happening, some area of non-base pairing, and then another bit of base pairing here, non-base pairing, and then it loops around and connects again. So RNA molecules are able to make these complex 3D shapes by pairing with themselves, just like you see in a protein where the amino acids fold around to make a complex 3D shape. And we know that those can bind to and catalyze reactions, bind to other molecules in a specific complementary sort of way. So RNA, and here's an example of a ribozyme, RNA can form an enzyme-like structure that can work on other RNA molecules to, for instance, cut them. It's also been experimentally shown the really early beginnings of RNA acting as an enzyme that can polymerase and make new RNA. And so it's possible that the earliest molecule that was doing the sort of functions of DNA and proteins in the cell was RNA. So RNA sits there right in the middle. And we know that RNA already does have all these different forms existing in cells at the moment. So think of tRNA. RNA is the ribosomal RNA that occurs within ribosomes and helps that translation process. And obviously there's messenger RNA. So RNA is a molecule has many functions already and can fulfill perhaps that idea of the earliest form of self-replicating molecule that allows life and cells to begin. But a lot of that is speculation and it's hard to find the evidence for this. So we'll take that as an assumption then that there's some sort of pre-cell protocell that has RNA in a membrane. Over time, if these are replicating and self-replicating, then we might expect a sort of population with some sort of diversity of ancestral cells. Next assumption is that then these might evolve over time, we'll talk about the process of evolution later, to create something that resembles an early prokaryote. And we have the beginnings of the prokaryotic cells that we still have existing today. So these have a simple genetic material in them in a DNA loop now, with some proteins and ribosomes in there and a membrane around it. Alongside that as well, we have the evolution of a different cell type, which is called archaea, which is very similar to the prokaryotes and is a little bit different, but an ancient type of single-celled organism that's quite similar to eukaryotic cells, but still doesn't have a nucleus. Then some stage along the evolutionary process here, we have a process which we call endosymbiosis, shown here, which leads to the formation of eukaryotic cells. And these form the other five kingdoms that we're aware of and we use as our classification: protists, fungi, plants, and animals. And what we're going to talk about in the next slide is how combinations of prokaryotic cells, these simple ancestral cells coming together or whatever, could create a more complex cell type that we call the eukaryotic cells. So here's a diagram that summarizes endosymbiosis. So you have some sort of proto-eukaryote. So it's basically like a prokaryotic cell here. It's got a membrane, it's got genetic material within that in terms of DNA. Doesn't have a nucleus, doesn't have any organelles yet. So how does the nucleus and organelles, how do they arise? Well, first of all, if you have an infolding of this membrane here from the outside of the plasma membrane, you can create vesicles within there and also some of these more complex things like the nucleus and the endoplasmic reticulum. So it's thought that the bubble of membrane around the nucleus actually came from an infolding of the plasma membrane. First step towards being eukaryotic. Second step here is that this organism might have consumed an aerobic bacterium. So some sort of aerobic bacterium, other bacterium living out there in the environment, was taken in, engulfed by this cell, but instead of just digesting it, it now incorporates it and it becomes part of the cell. So this was a free living bacterium that could do aerobic respiration. Now it's doing it inside this eukaryotic cell. So the eukaryotic cell gets an advantage from this because now it's able to take glucose, do aerobic respiration, get more ATP. The bacterium has an advantage because instead of being out there in the environment where it's quite dangerous and harsh, they're within a cell. So they've got a nice, safe, cozy environment to live in. Another step in this process then was perhaps a photosynthetic bacterium being engulfed by and incorporated into this eukaryotic cell. And this became the chloroplast. And so we can see here again the advantage for this cell to be incorporating it. Now this cell, instead of having to go out and find glucose, is able to produce its own glucose using sunlight and then pass that over to the mitochondria to produce ATP to give it energy. So great advantage for the cell, great evolutionary advantages, and so these will multiply and replicate faster than the cells that don't have this, and also an advantage for this bacterial cell because it's safely inside that other plasma membrane now. So what evidence is there behind this? So obviously there's evidence for this that we can look at, and there's multiple lines of evidence. Double nucleus around both chloroplasts and mitochondria. They have their own DNA, they have their own ribosomes, and in fact they replicate separately to the normal cell cycle in the eukaryote. So they're still dividing by a process very similar to binary fission, just like free living bacteria. So all these lines of evidence that at some stage the proto-eukaryote cell has evolved by taking in bacterial cells. So our own cells are then a product of amazing evolution like this, where we have these sort of ancestral forms of bacteria living inside each of our cells. So the final step here is then going from this sort of You've now evolved to being a unicellular cell, so a protist might be an example of that. How do we get to being multicellular organisms? So early on, and this still exists today, some unicellular organisms will live in closely packed colonies. So again, the advantage for them here is that there's sort of safety in numbers, and rather than spreading out when they divide, they stay together and form a loosely knit colony. And it's easy to imagine over generations, perhaps, that evolving to being, instead of just being sticking together a little bit, they become a clump and almost like an organism, one single organism. Within that, you might then start to have different cell types. So the ones on this side are locomotor, and they actually have the flagella and they swim around a little bit, whereas these ones have the chloroplasts and they can produce energy and food. And so we now have the beginnings of a multicellular organism, which will reproduce asexually, perhaps by splitting in two. The final stage is moving towards a multicellular sexually reproducing organism. And so you can here see again a different type of specialized cell. These ones become the gametes, the sex cells, that can separate from the original organism and fuse in a fertilization process to make a new organism. And so, although highly compressed, we see along here the steps from being unicellular to being a colony to being an organism that reproduces asexually to being one that reproduces sexually.